In the last part, we saw that the experience is experience of a memory. This memory should not be confused with your ability to recall phone numbers or faces or your shopping list. The memory is something very, very fundamental. As we defined it, the NPNM vibrations that are capable of storing patterns of information. So not only the phone numbers, each and every second of your experience is being recorded in the memory. Whatever we can recall is a faint copy of that which is in the memory. Now this drawing suggests that the memory is separate from the senses, and the senses are separate from the objects, and the objects are in the existence as they are seen. A shirt looks like a shirt. A clock looks like a clock. A shopping bag looks like a shopping bag. And a body looks like that. Thoughts are exactly that in the form they are perceived. This is a very, very simplistic view of what we actually experience. We think that the objects with their shapes and colors, they exist outside somewhere, and then the light hits them and eyes form an image of them. This image somehow magically is then known, perceived, cognized, and it is the image of a real object. And so we can use this simple model very effectively as far as survival is concerned. But as we saw in the last part and parts before that, what we experience is a memory, and the memory has impressions that are created literally using the senses. What exists out there is information, not objects. The objects are an appearance. When I say information, it also needs a place to reside. The information cannot hang in void. So, the memory that we are experiencing is not limited to my memory, our memory in the head. The objects also reside in the memory as information. So, whatever is drawn on the left side of this picture is actually residing in a memory. The same kind of memory that we are experiencing. And it is the NPNM memory. The memory is not in your head. Your head is in the memory. This view is closer to the reality of this illusion. The head is also an object, a pattern of information in the sea of memories. So is your shirt, your coffee mug, your shopping bag, your phone, and everything, including the body, the sensations of the body, the mental phenomena. Thoughts, emotions, perceptions, imaginations, and recalls of the memories. They are all memory patterns. What we get to see or hear is a transformed version of these patterns, the filtered version of these patterns, through the gates of senses that impinge on our local memory, which produces an experience. So now you can say that, wait a minute, it's okay that the objects are information. It's okay that I'm experiencing a memory, but the senses must be real, because it takes a real thing to transform the information into a memory pattern. And there can be a surprise for many people here that the senses themselves are in memory. They are just processes that run in the memory, and whatever hits them gets transformed and then arranged into the local memory. So you must have noticed, I am now calling the memory that is being experienced as local memory. Just to distinguish it from the other memories, which we can call as the universal memory. So the senses are a part of the universal memory. Just like everything else, because they are found on the body or inside the body or in the mind. They are just patterns in the memory. Just like everything else, except they have some special abilities to filter, to limit whatever hits them, whatever impinges on them. So your eyes not only produce a memory and perception, they themselves are a memory pattern. They reside in the memory. In fact, you can make a law that everything that can be experienced resides in a memory. All experience is experience of some memory. Whether it is transformed or not, they are just information patterns. So now another question can arise here. For those who are new to this kind of worldview, is that, wait a minute, the objects are in memory, the senses are in memory, and my experiences happen in memory, are of the memory. But there must be something in middle. There is some reality which is not accounted for. Otherwise, how can the patterns in the universal memory arrive in the senses, and then through the senses they arrive in the local memory? There cannot be void in between, because obviously the sound travels in something, light travels in space. There has to be this space, there has to be air in between whatever is in universal memory and wherever these senses are and the body is and whatever is in local memory. There has to be something there. It cannot be void, because there is an obvious connection there. And that is true. The senses are located in the body, and if I say body is in memory, the senses are automatically in the memory, and there is no question of gap. The senses themselves reside in the same memory space where the body is and other objects are. Mental objects, they reside in the same memory space where the body and other objects are. And since they are in contact with the body objects and mental objects, all these senses, they are in the same memory space. They don't belong to another memory. And there is no third memory which is located somewhere else called local memory. The local memory is also part of the universal memory. It is just another structure there. So we can fill in the diagram here to show that everything is memory. There are no gaps. And this memory is non-local, non-temporal, non-physical and non-mental. There is no possibility of gaps there. It is not extended in space. It is not extended in time. These are all illusions produced by mental processes. Everything is right now, right here, as a zero-dimensional memory, as a zero-dimensional vibration. And this is very difficult to comprehend. So we make models. We allow a little bit of approximation there, a little bit of assumptions there in order to comprehend, because our intellect can only comprehend things in time and space as distinct entities. That is how our intellect is built up. It is evolved to survive in this kind of virtual model. So that is why I am showing everything extended in a rectangle of memory where I have placed stuff in it. And I place the senses and I place the local memory there. But it is not like this in reality. The picture is not to be confused with the actual, because the actual is beyond intellect, cannot be even imagined. The map is not the territory. This is only a map, of the illusion. So it is just one memory, a sea of memory, and there are different patterns in it. And we have simply separated them out on this drawing just to understand. Just to talk about them. It is all right here, right now, at the same time, at the same location. So how do the senses get in touch with what is not in their memory space? We imagine a change that travels from the memory space where objects are, or the body is, or the thoughts, emotions are, to senses. Remember, the objects are nothing but vibrations, patterns of vibrations. And they are producing a modulation all the time. Since they are in the memory, the adjacent memory cells are influenced by the pattern, the vibrating pattern. In other words, the pattern gets copied in the neighboring cells of the memory. Here, the memory cell is also an abstraction. There are no such cells in reality. It is just a model. Since these cells are surrounded by other cells, the pattern is again copied, and the pattern or this copy propagates in all directions in the memory. The copying is through induction, if you recall our previous episodes. It is through resonance, and this disturbance then travels till it hits one of the special memory pattern which we call as the sense. The sense is another structure in the memory, and as soon as the disturbance hits it, which has the information regarding the original pattern which we are calling an object, it starts to limit it, it starts to process it, organize it, and then it is relayed to the local memory, where it is again arranged with respect to previous patterns, and it then shines as an experience, as a perception. This organized pattern is called knowledge, and we come to know what just happened and what is out there. In the previous episodes, I've discussed why we only perceive this local memory, not the object directly. Here I can give you another metaphor. Imagine the simple pinhole camera. Imagine that there is a tree outside and there is a cardboard sheet with a hole in it, and on the wall or on the screen, on a paper, you can see the image of the tree. Obviously, it will be inverted, but let's ignore that for the sake of metaphor. You will notice that without the cardboard, there is no image, because everything from the window is coming and hitting the screen or the wall. If you place the cardboard without a hole, then there is darkness, nothing hits it. If you make a large hole in the cardboard, you will find that there is a very, very blurry image there of the window or things outside the window, probably just green light, nothing else. If you narrow down the hole to the size of a pin, you will find that there is a sharp image of the tree now on the wall. It is counterintuitive. We are limiting the information coming from the trees outside. Still, we are getting a better perception. We are getting more defined lines there instead of a complete blur. If you think about it, it is very natural. It is happening out of necessity, because if all the information strikes the wall without any arrangement, without any limitations, everything is going to overlap. Nothing will be seen. As soon as it is limited, organized, it forms a meaningful pattern there, which is a copy of the pattern that is outside. It is just necessity. Nothing else is possible. Although it is only a metaphor, this does not in any way show how the actual process works of perception. But in a similar way, the senses are responsible for limiting almost infinite amount of information that is out there, outside the local memory, which if it hits the local memory will result in total chaos only. There will be no organization there. Nothing meaningful will be experienced. But if it comes through limiting structures and is formatted and is related with previous patterns that are in the memory, then it produces a meaningful experience. And that is why this experience stands out, stands apart from the chaos, which is just white or black or gray, just to use some poetic words. Means there is nothing meaningful there. Anything that is limited and organized will be seen as meaningful. So it is a little bit counterintuitive that even though the senses limit the range of information that we can perceive, there is no experience without them. Or it is the experience of everything which is equal to meaningless experience. It is just like you making the pinhole very big or removing the cardboard totally. The wall is getting the experience of everything, but actually it is meaningless, just a blur. There are many modes in which the objects send away the information. You must have guessed it, that there is light and there is sound and there is heat and there is smell, touch and everything. Plus, there are internal senses that are sensing the inside of the body pains and pleasures. The emotional states, which are nothing, they are also patterns. And the activities of the local memory itself, which are recall, imagination, thinking, and whatnot. There are hundreds of activities in the local memory itself. Just like there are hundreds of activity of the body, and there are almost infinite amount of objects, changes going on in the world. They are all being experienced in this way. This removes the other inferior models which distinguish between the objects and the mind, or the body and the objects, and are totally confused about the senses. What are the senses? They don't know what is it. This model clears it up completely. So the light is only a disturbance in the NPNM memory, which travels via copying of vibrations. The sound is interesting because it is a disturbance in the structures in the memory. Air is one such structure. Metals or wood is another structure. The wood is in memory as a structure, and it allows the disturbance to go through it. That is sound. That is also vibration. Similarly, the body sends a disturbance to the nervous system. If it requires something, if requires food, or there is a pain somewhere, something is damaged there, that is already formatted actually. So the whole nervous system is a sense actually. The sense organs are just outlets. Just like your camera is not only the lens, the whole of it is camera. So your eyes are not the only sense organ. There is a whole amount of circuitry there. The eyes themselves are a part of brain actually. The whole sense is not visible, only the outer part of it is visible. Similarly, nose is not a sense organ. The actual sense extends in the nervous system. And the ear, external ear, are not sensing anything. The actual sensors are inside the ear. The ears are only a pointing device. They just gather sound better. Similarly, whole of our skin is touch, including the nervous system in it. The senses extend into the mental realm, which is not separate from the physical, actually. Here you can see there is no separation. Only the types are different, the modes are different, that's all. So if you imagine an object, imagine a plate full of your favorite food, this memory is being played back through the internal sense, which is a part of the visual apparatus. If you remove the sense of vision in the first place, there won't be, you know, no imagination will be possible, no visualization will be possible. But if you remove the internal parts of the vision, then also no visualization will be possible. The senses, as I said, they extend in the whole local memory. So imagination, you can see it as a reverse of perception. In case of perception, the disturbance is coming from outside through the senses into the local memory. In case of imagination, the disturbance starts at the local memory, reaches the senses, and is again reflected back into the local memory as faint images. It is amazing. Now, there is something even more amazing that I am calling these things as patterns of information or vibration in the memory, but they are never experienced as patterns. When we hear sound, we do not perceive vibrations. We perceive tones, pitch, and volume. When we see things, we do not see vibrations, something vibrating. We see colors. Similarly for other senses. Similarly for emotions and thoughts and anything else. Never see vibrations. The experience appears as these mysterious forms. Colors, tones, smells, tastes, emotions, feelings, sensations, pains. What are these? It seems that there is one corresponding to each sense. Or it can be reversed. Probably there is one sense corresponding to each of these qualities. In fact, they are called qualities, but I am going to call them irreducibles. The word quality is too broad and therefore meaningless. Not only is all the experience of this memory, all the experience is actually experience of these irreducibles. This is, you can say, unit experience. The experience is formed out of these irreducible atomic experiences. There is no other experience. So what are these irreducibles? Just like the name suggests, they are fundamental. They cannot be explained in terms of something else. You can explain an experience in terms of irreducibles. That is possible. But you cannot explain the irreducible in terms of any other experience. If you ask me, what is this red color? Well, red is red. There is no description of it. So it is the fundamental appearance out of which all the appearances are made up of. Remember that it is an appearance. There is no pattern called red in the memory. There is no pattern called sweet or hot or cold in the memory. This is how the experience appears. We are going to talk about irreducibles and perception in more detail in the next part.